play some theater with him?
Well, it's a new experience for me to have to wait until 3 o'clock in the morning for my daughter to be brought home with me.
Oh, Dr. Harper, I hope you don't disapprove of Mortimer.
Well...
I mean, we'd feel so guilty if you did, Sister Martha and I. Since it was here in our home that your daughter met Mortimer.
Well, I understand that, and let me start off immediately by saying I believe that Mortimer himself to be quite a worthy gentleman. I just watched growing intimacy between him and Elaine with some trepidation for one reason this evening.
You mean stomach, Dr. Harper?
Stomach?
His dyspepsia always bother with its soap, poor boy.
No, I'm talking about your son's unfortunate connection with the theater.
The theater? Oh, no, Dr. Harper. Mortimer writes for a New York newspaper.
Yes, but dramatic critics, the more they write for the theater, they seem to become more fond of it.
Well, not Mortimer. You need have no fear of that. Why, Mortimer hates the theater.
Really?
Oh, yes, he writes awful things about it, but you can't blame him, poor boy. He was so happy writing about real estate, which he really knows nothing about, and then they just made him take this terrible night position. But, as he says, the theater can't last much longer, and in the meanwhile, it's living. Yes, I think if we give the theater another year or two, perhaps...
Thank God for that.
Just their way of doing it. destined to meet him?
No, it's such a shortcut through the cemetery. Whatever happened to
him? No, dear.
Oh, yes, we don't need him here. Do you mind, Carly?
Not at all. Must speak to Mortimer about doing this to you.
Doing what?
Well, he was brought up to know better. You know, when a gentleman calls for a lady, he should always call for her at her house.
Oh, there's something about calling for a girl at a parsonage that discourages any man who doesn't embroider. He's done this too often. We're going to speak with him.
Oh, please don't. After young men whose idea of nightlife was taking me to a prayer meeting, it's wonderful to go to the theater almost every night of my life.
Oh, it's comforting for us too. Mortimer has to see some of the plays he has to see. Well, at least he's sitting next to a minister's daughter.
My goodness, Lane, what must you think of us not having the tea cleared away by this time?
Yes, Father must have been surprised not to find me at home. I'd better run and say goodnight to him.
Oh, it's a shame you missed him, dear.
If Mortimer comes, you tell him I'll be right back.
Outside? My lord. Lord Martha? Looks very nice in here.
Oh, Abby! Mortimer's here!
Are you going somewhere?
Oh, I was just running over to tell Father not to wait up for me tonight.
Didn't know that was still being done, even in Brooklyn.
Hello, Mortimer.
Hello, Aunt Abby.
How are you, dear?
Fine. You look well. You haven't changed much since yesterday.
How good as it was yesterday, wasn't it? But
come, sit down.
Oh, Abby, how much we things to do in the kitchen?
Huh?
You know, the tea things.
The tea things. Well, you two just make yourselves at home. Just make yourselves at home.
Obvious, a lack of inventiveness, I should say.
Yes, that's exactly what you'd say.
What do you want to go for dinner?
I don't care. I'm not very hungry.
Well, I just had breakfast. Suppose we wait until after the show?
But that'll make it pretty late, won't it?
Not with the little stinker we're seeing tonight. From what I hear, we'll be at Blake's by 10 o'clock.
You ought to be fair to these plays.
Are these plays fair to me?
I've never seen you walk out on a musical.
Darling, that musical isn't opening tonight.
No.
Dear, you'll have to learn the rules. When it comes to shows like this, there are always 4 changes of title and 3 postponements. New Haven liked it, but it could use a lot of work.
Oh, I was hoping it was a musical.
Darling, you have such a light mind.
Not a bit. Musicals somehow have a humanizing effect on you. After a serious play, we join the proletariat on the subway, and I listen to a lecture on the drama. After a musical, you bring me home in a taxi, and you make a few passes.
Now, darling, that's a very inaccurate piece of reporting.
Oh, I will admit that after the Vernon play, you told me you had authentic beauty. And that's a heck of a thing to say to a girl. It wasn't until after our first musical you told me I have nice legs, and I have to.
You know, for a minister's daughter, you sure know a lot about life. Where'd you learn it?
In the choir loft.
I'll explain that to you sometime, dear. The close connection between eroticism and religion.
Religion never gets as high as in the choir loft. Which reminds me, I'd better run and tell Father not to wait up for me tonight.
Never been able to rationalize it.
What?
Oh, just my falling in love with a girl who lives in Brooklyn.
Falling in love? You're not doing so articulate, are you?
The only way I can regain my self-respect is to keep you in New York.
Did you say keep?
No. I'm convinced you're holding out for the legalities.
I can afford to be a good girl for quite a few years yet.
And I can't wait that long. Where could we be married in a hurry? Say tonight?
I'm afraid Father will insist on officiating.
Oh, God, I'll bet even he could make the marriage service sound pedestrian.
Are you by any chance writing a review of it?
Forgive me, dear. It's an occupational disease. Maybe if that plays on that, it would notice.
No, darling, don't pretend you love me that much.
I'll telephone Winchell to publish the bands.
Nevertheless.
Just this, Mr. President. The country is squarely behind you.
Yes, I know. Wasn't it? Well, goodbye. Goodbye.
Where are you off to, Teddy?
Panama!
Panama's the cellar. He digs lots for the canal down there.
Oh, you're so sweet to him. And he's very fond of you.
Yes, well, Teddy was always my favorite brother.
Favorites? Were there more of you?
Yes, there was another brother, Jonathan.
I've never heard of him. Your aunt never mentioned him.
No, we don't like to talk about Jonathan. He was, let's just say he left Brooklyn very early, by request. He was the sort of boy who liked to cut worms in two with his teeth.
What became of him?
I don't know. He wanted to be a surgeon like grandfather, but he wouldn't go to medical school first, and his practice got him into trouble.
Aren't you two going to be late for the theater?
We're skipping dinner.
Well, then I'll just leave you two alone together again.
Oh, don't bother, darling. I'm running over to see Father.
Before I go out with you, let's pray over me a little. I'll be right back. I'll cut through this unfairly.
No, Elaine. Prayer isn't too long. I have time to lead you beside the distilled waters.
Danita Carnina.
Well, no, that's Emma B. Stout descending to heaven.
No, on Mrs. Stout's left ear. That's a red-crested swallow. I've only seen one of those before in my entire life.
I don't know how you could be thinking about a bird now, but with Elaine and the engagement and everything.
It's a vanishing species. Thoreau was very fond of them. By the way, I left a large envelope around here sometime last week. Have you seen it?
Well, if you left it here, it must be around here somewhere.
When are you going to be married? What are your plans? Oh, there must be something more you could tell us about Elaine.
Elaine? Oh, yes, she thought it was brilliant.
What was, dear?
My chapter on Thoreau.
Well, I think when Elaine gets back, I think we ought to have a little celebration. Do much drink to your happiness. Martha, isn't there some of that Lady Baltimore cake left?
Oh, yes.
Now I'll put a bottle of wine.
Where could I have put that?
Well, if your fiance is sitting beside you tonight, I do hope this play is something you can enjoy for once. What was the name of it?
Murder Will Out.
Oh.
That's right. When the curtain opens, the first thing you'll see will be a dead body. Tabby! He's got to be convicted right away.
Why, Mortimer, how can you say such a thing? Why, as long as we live, we'll never be separated from Teddy.
Now, darlings, I have some very shocking news for you. Now, we're going to have to try and keep our heads. You know how up until now we've sort of humored Teddy because we thought he was harmless?
Why, he is harmless.
He was harmless. That's why he's got to go to Happy Dale now. He has to be convicted. Sometime. Might as well be now. Teddy's
get in the wine?
Well, we put it in the wine because it's less noticeable. When we put it in tea, it has a distinct odor.
You put it in the wine?
Yes, and I hope Mr. Hoff can do it, Rosie.
What is to be done with him?
Well, Panama is down there, and then Teddy's digging the lock.
You mean you're going to bury Mr. Hotchkiss in the cellar?
Hoskins, dear.
Whatever his name is, you can't do that.
Well, that's what we did with the others.
No, you can't bury Mr. Others?
The other gentleman.
When you say others, do you mean others? More than one others?
Well, yes, this is 11, isn't it, Daddy?
No, dear, this makes 12.
No, I think you're wrong. This is 11.
No, because it occurred to me when Mr. Hoskins first came in that he'd make just an even dozen.
Well, you can't really count the first one.
Oh, I was counting the first one, so that makes 12.
Hello? City desk. Hello, Al. Do you know who this is? That's right. Say, Al, when I left earlier, I told you where I was going, didn't I? Well, where did I say? Uh-huh. That's right, I must be here. Now, let's see, where were we? 12!
Yes, Abby thinks that we should count the first one, and that makes 12.
Who was the first one?
Mr. Bidgley. He was a Baptist.
Go on.
Well, Mr. Bidgley came here looking for a room.
He was such a lonely old man.
His kids and kin were dead and it left him so forlorn and unhappy.
We felt so sorry for him.
Then, when he sat dead in that chair and looking so peaceful, we made up our minds then and there that if we could help other lonely old men to the same peace, we would.
You mean he just sat down and died right in that chair? How awful for you!
Oh no, it was rather like old times. You know how your grandfather always had a cadaver or two around the house?
Your aunt was back from mixing things. You made enough of her pickle, Lily.
And for every gallon of elderberry wine, I'd take one teaspoonful of arsenic, a half a teaspoon of strychnine, and just a pinch of cyanide.
Should have quite a kick.
Yes, as a matter of fact, one of our gentlemen found time to say, how delicious.
Delicious.
Well, I really must see about things in the kitchen.
Oh, I wish you could stay for dinner.
I'm trying out a new recipe.
I couldn't eat a thing.
I'll come help you in a minute, dear. Life looks so much better now. Oh, you have to wait for Elaine, don't you? How happy you must be. Well, dear, I'll leave you alone with your thoughts.
Still on.
Now, you run along Bloomy Lane. I've got to do something.
Listen, you can't propose to me 1 minute and throw me out of the house the next.
I'm not throwing you out, darling. Will you get out of here?
No, I will not get out of here. Not until I've had some kind of explanation.
Be like, oh. Hello? Hold on for a moment, won't you? Yes, I know it's important, but it can wait, can't it? Hold on! Look, Elaine, you're a sweet girl and I love you. But I need you to go home and wait until I call you.
Don't try to be masterful.
When we're married and I have problems to face, I hope you're less tedious and uninspired.
And when we're married, if we're married, I hope I find you adequate.
Elaine! Hello? Me, Mort. We got cut off. Listen, Al, I need you to get hold of George for me. I can't review that play tonight. That's all there is to it. I can't.
What church are you from? There's just one down the street.
I'm Presbyterian.
Well, there has to be somebody around the place. Look, Al, you go around the office. Al, hold on.
Is there always this much noise?
He doesn't live with us.
What's George doing in Bermuda? Certainly I told him he could go to Bermuda. It's my department, isn't it?
Oh, why don't you try that for a wine before we start out?
Never touch it.
Elderberry wine.
Elderberry wine. Haven't had it since I was a boy. Thanks.
Oh, come on, Al. No, I'm sober as a lark. I'm not drinking, but I'm going to start now. Somewhere, but before I go, I need you to do something for me.
We'd have to know what it was first.
I love you, and I know you love me, and you know I wouldn't want anything to happen to you.
What do you want us to do?
Don't do anything. I mean, don't do anything. Don't let anyone in this house, and leave Mr. Hoskins right where he is.
Why?
was a Methodist.
Can't that wait until I get back?
Oh, then you can join us.
Yes! Yes!
Oh, Mortimer, you'll enjoy the services, especially the hymns. Remember how beautifully Mortimer used to sing in the church before his voice changed?
And you won't let anyone in this house while I'm gone. Well, it's a promise.
Well, Martha, we can do that now. Mortimer's cooperating with us.
Well, all right, Mortimer.
Have you got some paper? Anything will do.
Here's some stationery. Will this do?
This will do fine. There's a man I've got to see. But I can save time if I write my review on the way to the theater.
Mortimer didn't seem quite himself today.
Well, it's only natural, and I think I know why.
Why?
He's just become engaged to be married. I suppose that always makes a man nervous.
Oh, yes. Their honeymoon should give Mortimer a real vacation. I mean, he hasn't got much rest this summer.
Oh, he's either heading off to China or Spain.
I never understood why he wanted to go to those places.
Well, I think Mortimer, the theater's always seemed pretty small potatoes. He had something big to criticize. Something like...
Oh, well, yes. Oh, I've drunk in on Mrs. Schultz, and she's much better. She wants us to take Junior to the movies again.
Oh, well, let's do it tomorrow, the next day.
Yes, but we're not going to let him drag us into one of those scary pictures.
No, never again. Do you suppose anybody was supposed to be coming in?
We weren't supposed to let anyone in.
Well, nothing is supposed to, that is.
Still not supposed to let them in.
Just go see who they are.
It's two men. I have never seen them before.
Are you sure?
Yes, and there's a car by the curb. They must have come in that.
Let me look.
Do you recognize them?
They're strangers to me.
Oh, well, we'll just have to act like we're not here.
The home of my youth. As a boy, I couldn't wait to escape from this place. Now I'm glad to escape back into it.
Yeah, Shawty, a fine hideout.
The family must still live here. There's something so unmistakably Brewster about the Brewsters. I hope there's a fatted calf awaiting the return of the bridal.
Yeah, I'm hungry. Look, Shawty, drinks.
As though we were expected. A good omen.
Who are you? What are you doing here?
Why, Aunt Abby. Aunt Martha. It's Jonathan.
Why
aren't
I Jonathan? Don't pretend you are. Get out of here.
Yes, get out.
I'm Jonathan, your nephew, Jonathan.
Oh, no, you're not.
But I am Jonathan. And this is Dr. Einstein.
He's not Dr. Einstein, either.
Not Dr. Albert Einstein. Dr. Herman Einstein. Well, you don't think it's me?
Just get out of here!
I see you're still wearing that lovely garnet ring Grandma Brewster bought in England. And you, Aunt Martha, still the high collar to hide the scar where Grandfather's acid burned you.
Well, his voice does sound like...
No. My face. Dr. Einstein is responsible for that. He's a plastic surgeon. He changes people's faces.
Oh, but I've seen that face before. Abby, do you remember the little Schultz boy who took to the movies? It was that face!
Easy, Chani. Ladies, over the past 5 years, I've given Chani 3 new faces. I'll get him a new one right away.
You see what you've done to me, Doctor? Even my own family!
Shani, you're in this beautiful home. How often he tells me of this place, of his beautiful aunts. Come on, Shani, they remember you.
Well, Shani,
Hannah and I were in business together.
Well, we were in Chicago for the World's Fair. Chicago got awfully warm for us.
Yeah, got hot for us, too.
Well, it's wonderful to be in Brooklyn again. And you, Abby, Bartha, you don't look a day older. Just as I remembered you. Sweet, charming, hospitable. And dear Teddy, did he get into politics? My little brother, Doctor, was determined to become president.
Well, Teddy's fine, just fine, and Mortimer's well, too.
I've heard about Mortimer. I've seen his picture at the head of his column. He's evidently fulfilled all the promise of his early, nasty nature.
We're very fond of Mortimer.
Well, bless you, aunties. It's wonderful to be home again.
Martha, we mustn't let the stove boil over.
Yes, if you'll excuse us, unless you wanted to go somewhere.
Well, Johnny, where do we go from here? The police, they got pictures of that face. And we can't leave Mr. Spinoza in the rumble seat.
Don't waste a worry on that rat.
We got a hot stiff in the car. What do you mean, don't worry?
Forget Mr. Spinoza.
He was a nice guy, Johnny. He gave us a lift. You shouldn't have killed him.
He said I looked like Boris Karloff. That's your work, Doctor. You did that to me.
Easy, Johnny. I'll get you fixed up right away. We'll find a place to operate.
Tonight.
No, Johnny, not tonight.
Well, Jonathan, we're glad you remembered us and took the trouble to come and say hello. But you were never happy in this house, and we were never happy while you were in it, so we've just come to say goodbye.
Why, Aunt Abby, I can't say that your feeling towards me comes as a surprise. I've spent a great many hours regretting the many heartaches I must have given you as a boy.
You were quite a trial to us, Jonathan.
But my great disappointments for Dr. Einstein. I always promised him that no matter how rushed we were in passing through Brooklyn, we'd take the time to stop by at one of Aunt Martha's home coaches.
Oh! I'm sorry, I'm afraid there wouldn't be enough.
Abby, it's a pretty good-sized pot roast.
Pot roast!
Well, we'll hurry it along.
Bless you, we'll stay here. Oh, is Grandpa's laboratory still there?
Yes, if you want to use it to freshen up, you can. I'm
going to
go help her get started.
Doctor, Grandfather's laboratory, and just as it was, a perfect operating room.
Too bad we can't use it.
Why, when you finish with me, we could make a fortune here.
Johnny, we're not invited here. We can't use it.
We're here for dinner, aren't we?
And then what?
Doctor, leave it to me. I'll handle it. Why, this house will be our headquarters for years.
That would be a dream come true. It's peaceful here.
That's what makes this house so perfect. It's so peaceful. Changed the whole course of my life. You remember, I had been in South Africa in the diamond business, then Amsterdam, the diamond market. I wanted to go back to South Africa, and Dr. Einstein made it possible for me.
A good job. When the nurse took out the bandages, she had to introduce me.
I love that face. I still carry the picture with me.
Well, this looks more the way you used to look, but I still wouldn't know you.
I think we'll go back to that face, Doctor.
Yeah, it's safe now.
Well, I'm sure you both want to get to where you're going.
My dear aunties, I'm so full of that delicious dinner. I'm unable to move a muscle.
Yeah, it was nice.
Well, it's getting pretty late.
General. I guess President Roosevelt and General Goldwell at the Gobert Cut.
My, how I've changed.
You see, that picture hasn't been taken yet. We haven't even started work on the Gobert Cut. And now, General, you will come with me to Panama to inspect the new lock.
No, Teddy, not to Panama.
We go some other time. It's a long way away.
Nonsense! It's just on the cellar.
The cellar?
We let him dig the Panama Canal down there.
General Goldfuss, as President of the United States, Commander-in-Chief of the Navy, and the man who gave you this job, I command that you come with me for the inspection of the new lock.
Teddy, I think it's time you went to bed.
I beg your pardon!
I'm Woodrow Wilson. Go to bed.
No, you're not Wilson. But your face is familiar. Yes. On my hunting trip to Africa, you look like a man I'd meet in the jungle.
It's your brother Jonathan, dear.
He's had his face changed.
So that's it, a nature faker!
And perhaps you'd better go to bed. Jonathan and his friend have to go back to their hotel.
General Goldfuss, inspect the canal.
No, that's folly! That's folly! Here, let me grab this. It's down south, you know.
Why, Aunt Debbie, I must correct your misapprehension. You spoke of our hotel. We have no hotel. We came directly here.
Well, there's a nice little hotel.
Aunt Martha, this is my home.
I'm afraid you can't stay here, Jonathan. We need our rooms.
You need them?
Yes, for our lodgers.
Are there lodgers in this house?
Not yet, but we plan to have some.
Then my old room is still free.
But, Jonathan, there's no room for Dr. Einstein.
He'll share the room with me.
No, Jonathan, I'm afraid you can't stay here.
Dr. Einstein and I need a place to sleep. You remembered this afternoon that, as a boy, I could be disagreeable?
Abby, maybe we should let them stay tonight. Well, just overnight, Jonathan.
That's it, all? If you'll get my room ready.
It just needs airing out.
We should be ready to show our lodgers. I think you and Dr. Einstein will find it comfortable.
You have a most distinguished guest, Dr. Einstein. I'm afraid you don't appreciate his skill. But you will. In a few weeks, you will see me looking like a very different Jonathan.
He can't operate on you here.
When Dr. Einstein and I get organized, when we resume practice. Oh, I forgot to tell you. We're turning Grandfather's laboratory into an operating room.
Jonathan, we will not let you turn this house into a hospital.
A hospital? Heavens no. It will be a beauty parlor.
Tony, down in the cellar.
My dear aunts have invited us to live with them, Doctor.
Oh, you fix it?
Well, you're sleeping here tonight.
Please get our room ready immediately. Panama Canal.
It's a hole that Mr. Spinoza exactly. 6 feet long and 4 feet wide.
Down there?
Yeah, it's almost like they expected him. That's hospitality.
Rather a good joke, my dear aunts. They're looking at us with a body buried in the cellar.
How do we get him in?
Yes. We can't just walk into the door. We'll drive the cart between the house and the cemetery. Then when they've gone to bed, we'll bring Mr. Spinoza in. Run along to bed. We're moving the car behind the house.
It's fine where it is for now.
I don't want to leave it in the street. That might be against the law.
Abby, what are we going to do?
Well, for one thing, we're not going to let them stay in this house more than one night. What would the neighbors think? People coming in here with one face and coming out with another?
Abby, what are we going to do about Mr. Hoskins?
Oh, Mr. Hoskins, it can be very comfortable for him in there.
General Goldfuss, hurry, please. He's in the canal just the right side.
Teddy,
never even seen Mr. Hoskins.
I could have said it right to you, Apple. Just come see him now. He's really very nice looking, considering he's a Methodist.
We're bringing the luggage through here.
Jonathan, your room's waiting for you.
Then you two run along to bed.
Well, you two must be very tired. We don't go to bed this early.
Well, you should. It's time I came home to take care of you.
We weren't planning to go.
Aunt Martha, did you hear me say go to bed? I can go up in the morning.
I'll wait for you to turn on the lights. Hurry along.
Another flight, Doctor. All right, Aunt Abby.
Go with you.
Hurry along, Aunt Martha.
I'll turn off the lights and go up.
Now, Aunt Abby, turn off the lights.
Let this open, dump cough.
Johnny, is that you? Okay, hand over to me.
Sorry, Johnny, I slipped.
Be careful. Turn on the lights. You chose rather an untimely moment for a social call.
I think you better explain what you're doing here.
We happen to live here.
You don't live here. I'm in this house every day, and I've never seen you before. Where are Miss Abby and Miss Martha? What have you done to them?
Perhaps we'd better introduce ourselves. This is Dr. Einstein. A surgeon of great distinction, and something of a magician.
And I suppose you're going to tell me your Forrest Carr.
I'm Jonathan Brewster.
Oh, you're Jonathan.
I see you've heard me.
Yes, just this afternoon for the first time.
And what did they say about me?
Only that there was another brother named Jonathan. That's all that was said. Well, that explains everything. Now that I know who you are, I'll be running along now. If you'll kindly unlock.
That explains everything. Just what did you mean by that?
I thought I saw someone prowling around the house. I suppose it was you.
You thought you saw someone prowling around the house?
Yes. Weren't you outside? Isn't that your car?
You saw someone at the car?
Yes.
What else did you see?
Only someone walking around the house to the car.
What else did you see?
Just that. That's all. That's why I came over here. You see, I was going to tell Abby to call Teddy, tell these men who I am.
My daughter, Alice.
Still there.
I've come back home, Mortimer.
It is your brother Jonathan, dear. This is Dr. Einstein.
I know this isn't a nightmare, but what is it? Who did you say this was?
It's your brother Jonathan. He's had his face changed and Dr. Einstein performed the operation.
Oh, God. Jonathan, you always were a horror, but do you have to look like one?
Mortimer. You remember the things I did to you when we were boys? The time you were tied to the bedpost? The needles under your fingernails?
By God, it is, Jonathan. Yes, I remember you. I remember you as the most vicious, venomous, detestable form of animal life I ever knew.
Now don't you two boys start quarreling the minute you've seen each other again.
There won't be any fight, Aunt Abby. Jonathan? You're not wanted here. Get out.
Dr. Einstein and I have been invited to stay.
Not in my house.
Well, just for tonight.
Fine. Just for tonight. But first thing in the morning, out! Where are they sleeping?
We put them in Jonathan's old room.
That's my old room! I'm sleeping there. I'm here to stay.
Oh, Mortimer, I'm so glad.
You know, all this argument's got me thinking about Mr. Spinalzo.
Spinalzo? Well, now, Mortimer. It really isn't necessary to inconvenience you like this. We'll sleep down here.
You bet your life you sleep down here.
You can sleep on the couch, honey. I'll sleep on the window seat.
The window seat? Well, let's not argue about that. The window seat is room enough for me. I'll sleep on the window seat.
Come on, Shani. We'll get packed. We'll sleep down here.
Don't bother, Doctor.
Well, Mortimer, you don't have to sleep down here. I can go.
Don't worry, Aunt Betty. We'll be packed in a few minutes and we'll come sleep down here.
You're wasting your time. I told you I'm sleeping down here. Practically gallops. That's why I can't marry you, dear.
Now, wait a minute.
minute. You've got to do better than that.
No. It goes far back. The first rooster, the one who came over on the Mayflower. You know how back in those days, the Indians used to scalp the settlers? Well, he used to scalp the Indians.
Whatever, that's ancient history.
No, it's even more soon than that. Grandfather, he used to patent his medicines out on dead people to make sure he wouldn't kill them.
He wasn't so crazy. He made $1 million.
But, and there's Jonathan, too. And you saw what happened with Jonathan. He tried to kill you.
But he's your brother, not you. I'm in love with you.
And then there's Teddy. You know Teddy. He thinks he's Roosevelt. No, dear. No rooster should marry.
Now, wait a minute, darling. All of this doesn't prove that you're crazy. Just look at your aunts. They're roosters, aren't they? And the sanest, sweetest people I've ever known.
Even they have their peculiarities.
What lovely peculiarities. Kindness, generosity, human sympathy.
There's another one. Something has just come up.
Up from where? We're here alone together.
Elaine, I need you to run along home.
Well, wait a minute. Listen, you can't. If you think you're going to get out of this by pretending you're insane, you're crazy. Maybe you're not going to marry me, but I'm going to marry you. I love you, you dope.
Well, if you love me, you will make your way out of here.
Well, at least take me home, won't you? I'm afraid.
Afraid? A little walk through the cemetery?
Mortimer, will you give me a kiss goodnight?
Of course I will, dear. Jonathan, wouldn't you let them see what's in the window seat?
Aunt Abby, I owe you an apology.
So, I've decided that, Jonathan and Dr. Einstein are leaving, and they're taking their cult companion with him.
Jonathan, you're my brother. You're a Brewster. I'm giving you the chance to take the evidence and leave. You can't ask for more than that.
Very well. I'll have to call the police.
Don't reach for that telephone. Are you still giving me orders after seeing what happened to Mr. Spinozzo?
Spinozzo?
Knew he was a foreigner?
What happened to Mr. Spinozzo can happen to you too.
Mr. Brewster, you just said you'd offer to help with me with my plot and my play.
I can't do that, O'Hara.
you that?
I can wait. I've been waiting 12 years.
Sorry,
I'm so lost.
Don't bring that in here! Oh, Kara, what do you say you go with that?
I would have known you'd grow up to write a play with a policeman.
You know something? I'm really glad that you're here, because it gives me a chance to throw you out. And the first one out will be your boyfriend, Mr. Spinoza.
Say, Mr. Brewster, we can talk in here.
Come on. I'll expect to see the three of you gone.
Between my brother and I, it's got to be settled.
How funny. Your brother, he gives us a chance to get away. What more could you ask for?
You don't understand, Doctor. This goes back a good many years.
Now, Chani, let's get going.
No. We're gonna stay right here. We're sleeping right here tonight!
The cop in the kitchen and Mr. Spinoza in the window seat?
That's all he's got on us. We'll take Mr. Spinoza down and dump him in the bay, and come right back here. If he tries to interfere,
Johnny.
Doctor, you know when I make up my mind.
I know when you make up your mind, you lose your head. Brooklyn ain't a good place for you.
Doctor!
Fine. If we're going to stay there, where am I going to put these?
You're going to leave them here. Hide them in the cellar. Move fast. Spinoza can go out the same way he came in.
Johnny, you know that hole in the cellar? Well, we got an ace of the hole. Come, I'll show you.
Jonathan! Jonathan!
Gentleman down there who seems to be very dead.
What were you doing down in the cellar?
What's he doing in the cellar?
Mr. Brewster, your aunt wanted to hear it too. Shall I bring them in here?
You've got to bring in.
But what's what they're bringing in? I'm going to grab your aunt and I'm going to tell you my plot, sir.
No, not in front of all these people.
Why don't you two go down in the cellar?
Is this the cellar?
Your cellar.
Absolutely not. It's criminal.
Murdered?
Murdered? Certainly not. It's one of our charities.
What we've been doing is a mercy.
You've done that here. In this house. Down there.
Johnny, we've been chased all over the world. And these ladies do just as good as you do.
What?
You've got 12, and they've got 12.
I've got 13.
No, Johnny. 12.
13! There's Mr. Spinoza, the first one in London. The two in Johannesburg, one in Sydney, one in Melbourne, two in San Francisco, and the one in Phoenix, Arizona.
Phoenix.
The filling station. The three in Chicago, and the one in South Bend. That makes 13.
You can't count the one in South Bend. He died of pneumonia.
He wouldn't have died of pneumonia if I hadn't shot him.
No, Johnny. He died of pneumonia. You've got 12, and they've got 12.
No. I've got 13.
No, Johnny. 12.
Well, that's easily taken care of. All I need is one more. Just one more. Well, here I am.
Report to headquarters.
now!
No, Johnny, not tonight. I'm tired, and tomorrow I got to operate.
Yes, Doctor, you're operating tomorrow. Tonight, we take care of Mortimer.
Johnny, no, not tonight.
Doctor, look at me. You can see it's going to be done, can't you?
I know that look.
It's a little too late for us to dissolve our partnership.
Okay, we got to stick together, as sometimes we got stuck together. But we do it the quick way, like in London, yeah?
No. I think this calls for something special. I think perhaps the Melbourne method.
Johnny, no, not the Melbourne method. 2 hours, and then it was over. The guy in Melbourne was just as bad as the guy in London.
You had to work too fast in London. There was no aesthetic satisfaction, but Melbourne. There was something to remember.
Remember? I wish I didn't. Johnny, not Melbourne, not me.
Doctor, where are your instruments?
I hope to tell you.
Get your instruments, Doctor!
No, Johnny.
Where are they? Oh, yes, you hid them in the cellar. Where?
I won't tell you.
I'll find them, Doctor. Wait!
Not that, Mr. President. But I have to call a cabinet meeting to sign any proclamation. It must be a secret.
Unusual.
Japan mustn't know until it's signed.
Japan! Devils! We'll send it immediately.
Yes, but at once, Mr. President.
I have to put on my shiny clothes.
You go now, yeah?
Anywhere.
Why not?
Look. You seem like a lovely fellow, and I have nothing against you personally. But you need to take my advice, go through that door, and go as far away as possible.
Yeah, you go through that door and get as far away as possible?
Things are going to start popping around here any minute.
You think I don't know that? When Johnny's like this, he's a madman.
I'm not afraid of Jonathan anymore.
Don't those plays teach you anything?
About what?
Well, at least the people in those plays have common sense.
You think in plays have sense? Take the little opus I saw tonight, for instance. Now you have a man. He's supposed to be bright. He's in a house full of murderers. He knows he's in danger. But does he leave? No. He stays there. He doesn't even have the sense enough to be frightened. What do you think happened next?
They asked him to sit down.
That one was in there. That's right. And what do you think he did?
Sits down.
He sits down. Now mind you, this fella's supposed to be bright. So, there he sits, and what do you think they used to tie him up with?
What?
The curtain cord.
Well, why not? It's convenient, isn't it?
A little too convenient. When are they going to start using some creativity? The curtain cord! Useless. And they say the critics are the ones killing the theater. It's the playwrights who are killing the theater. So there he sits, the big dope, just waiting to be trussed up and gagged!
Well now, Mortimer, I think I'll finish this story. I've been away for 20 years, Mortimer, but never once in all that time were you out of my mind. In Melbourne one night, I dreamed of you. When I landed in San Francisco, I felt a strange satisfaction. Once more, I was in the same country as you. We get to work now, Doctor.
No, Tony, not without a drink.
Doctor, pull yourself together.
No, Tony, I can't do this without a drink.
Where are your manners, Doctor? Mortimer, I now know that it was you who brought me to Brooklyn. All right, Doctor. To my dear dead brother. He goes next.
No, Johnny, not Teddy. That's where I stop.
We get to Teddy later.
No, Johnny, we don't get to Teddy at all.
We take care of Mortimer now.
Yeah, the quick way?
Yes, Doctor, the quick way.
Carl's got a quick blow with that whore!
Sorry, officer. We're taking the bugle away from him.
There's going to be hell to pay in the morning. And the neighbors, we promised the neighbors we wouldn't do that anymore.
It won't happen again. Good night, officer.
I better speak to him myself. Hey! You rank.
Where was I at?
Oh, yeah. 3 days later, I've been transferred in under charges. That's because somebody stole my badge. I'm walking my beat on Staten Island, 46th Precinct, when a guy I'm following is really following me. Don't let anybody in. So I figure I'll outsmart them. There's a vacant house on the corner. I goes in.
It's cops. Johnny, it's cops.
I stand there in the dark as I watch the door handle turn. I pull my guns, braces myself up against the wall. My sis, come in. Hello, boys. Well, this is Mortimer Brewster, and me and him are writing a play together. They sent you here for me.
No. We didn't know you was here.
Oh, we came to warn the old ladies. It's gonna be hell to pay in the morning. The Colonel blew the bugle again in the middle of the night.
From the way the neighbors had been calling in about it, you'd think the Germans had dropped a bomb on Flatbush Avenue.
Lieutenant on Warpath said the Colonel found it put away somewhere.
Yes! Yes!
Gee, I gotta get away now, so I'll just go through the third act real quick.
Get away from me!
Did you know it's after 8 o'clock in the morning?
It is? Them two first acts run a little long, but I don't see anything we can leave out.
You can leave it all out.
Who the heck is that guy?
That's my brother.
Oh, the one that ran away? So I can die.
Yes, he came back.
Brother of mine will split the reward.
Reward?
Just turning in. I suppose you think my sweet, charming old aunties are sweet and charming.
What the heck is going on here?
There's 13 bodies in the cellar.
Boop!
Wait a minute.
I'll prove it to you. Come down to the cellar with me.
You better go on down to the cellar with me.
I'm not so sure I want to go down in the cellar with him. Look at that puss. He looks like Boris Karloff.
Hey!
What the heck? Pass it off for me! What do you know about that?
Come in!
What the heck are you men doing here? I told you I was going to handle this.
Well, sir, we was just about to...
What happened? Did he put up a fight?
This ain't the fellow that blows the bugle. This is his brother. He tried to kill Klein.
All I said was he looked like Boris Karloff.
Turn him over.
I thought all along he talked kind of.
Your term of office is over.
Is this marked for talk?
Practically.
Oh, yes, now I'm on my hunting trip to Africa.
That's right.
Well, I must get my equipment immediately. Is he trying to get into the White House before I move?
Who, Teddy?
Taft!
This isn't Taft, Teddy. This is Mr. Witherspoon. He's to be your guide in Africa.
Oh, that's bully, just bully! I'll get my equipment at once.
Bye, Harry. Bye, Mother.
I'm going to Africa! Isn't it wonderful?
Ah! Look, Elaine, I'm glad you're here. Run along now, will you?
Nothing!
Hello, aunties.
Oh, we have visitors.
This is Captain...
Lieutenant.
Lieutenant Bruni.
Well, how do you think Lieutenant Bruni is a little bit of a fuss what the policemen say you are?
And this is Mr. Witherspoon.
Oh, Mr. Witherspoon, how do you do? You've come to meet Teddy.
He's come to take Teddy.
What?
No.
We won't permit it.
Not while we're alive.
I mean, for all we know, Teddy could have been... rattling on
about those bodies in the cellar.
The bodies in the cellar?
We might have to dig up your cellar.
But there's already graves marking.
But in the cellar, they're all marked.
Yes, there's some bodies in the cellar.
Well, don't you see?
Well, if you think that's right, Teddy has to go, then you come down with us and we'll show you.
I'll take your word for it, ladies. We can't take sane people to Happy Dale.
As you can see.
But you should come with us.
We'll show you the graves.
We put flowers on them every Sunday.
Flowers?
Well, now, don't you see? Don't you think you have a place for these ladies? They put flowers on graves.
Well, I...
Don't you think you find the room for them?
Well...
We've gotten commitment papers from our family physician, Dr. Gilchrist.
Why, certainly.
Can they sign the papers too?
Yes.
Come on over. Come on over. Come on over.
Lieutenant, they're coming around.
Good morning, Mr. Klein. Are you here too?
Yeah, me and Poppy have got your other nephew out in the kitchen.
Yes. Are they going to investigate those signatures?
Don't worry, they're not going to look up Dr. Einstein.
If
yours.
What?
You see, it's something we never really wanted to tell you, but now that you're a man, and it's something Elaine should know too. You see, dear, you're not really a Brewster.
Well, your mother came to us as a cook, and you were born about 3 months afterward. And she was such a sweet woman, such a good cook, that we didn't want to lose her, so never married her.
I'm not really a Brewster.
Now, don't feel too badly about it, dear.
And Elaine, this will make no difference to you.
Elaine, did you hear? Do you understand? I'm a bastard!
Well, I really must see about breakfast.
Mortimer's coming over to my house. Father's down to Philadelphia, and Mortimer and I are going to have breakfast together.
Yes, I've had quite a night.
In that case, I think you'd want to get to bed.
I do. One moment with this spoon. Take this.
We won't need the wagon. My car's out front.
Oh, Jonathan, you're leaving?
Yes, he's going back to Indiana. There are people who want to take care of him for the rest of his life.
Well, that's nice to know you have someplace to go, Jonathan.
Yes, we're leaving too.
We're going to Happydale.
Then this house is seeing the last of the Brewsters.
Unless Mortimer wants to live here.
I have a suggestion to make. Why don't you turn this property over to the church?
I never thought of that.
After all, it should be part of the cemetery. Well, goodbye, aunties. I can't better my record, but neither can you. At least I have that satisfaction. The score stands even. 12-12.
Jonathan always was a mean boy. Never could stand to see anyone get ahead of him.
What's the good show that he isn't so smart? Mr. Witherspoon, does your family live with you at Happydale?
I have no family.
Oh.
But you must consider everyone at Happydale your family. I don't think you quite understand. As head of the institution, I have to keep quite aloof.
Well, Martha. I think if Mr. Witherspoon will join us for breakfast, I think we should offer him a glass of our elderberry wine.
Elderberry wine? Yes, we make it ourselves.
Right here.